What's happening, family? Happy Thursday to each of you. I hope each of you are well and blessed, as we always say. I hope you've had a wonderful day, a productive day, a prosperous day. I hope you're looking good, feeling good, smelling good. Let's get after it. So, here we are, gang, and what I will say is, boy, and my, hasn't time flown by? Isn't it amazing how quickly this time has gone? I mean, here we are on hump day night, and tomorrow is Thursday. That's absolutely incredible. Cheers. So, where do I start? Shout out to my team. Shout out to all my leaders, super leaders, ambassadors, governors, my Hawks. Shout out to each of you. Special shout out to all of our international participants. We got people in Africa. We got people in Canada. We got people in the United Kingdom. We've got people in Germany. We've got people, they're all over the world. So shout out to you guys. I know that our time frame may throw you off, may be too late for some of you, too early, but you guys are coming along nicely. So shout out to each of you. I hope everybody is well. Everybody's well. So, we got quite a session, gang. Quite a session. Let me see if I can, before we get started, let me give you some insight in terms of where this comes from. This particular session was, like I told you, inspired by the Black Health presentation that I did on last Tuesday. This isn't a continuum of that, but the subject matter was inspired. Tonight's subject matter was inspired by that. And it's called No More Heart Attacks, No More Strokes, How to Live and Not Die. Love the title. Shout out to Eva, Germany in the building. Shout out to Eva. How to Live and Not Die. No more heart attacks, no more strokes, how to live and not die. Now, I've never taught this before. So one thing that I can say is each of you will be, if I'm able to present it with power and clarity, each of you will be blessed by the content, regardless of your race, ethnicity, gender, and age. That's the beauty. When you watch this, you will instantly increase your probability of avoiding a heart attack or stroke if you listen to what I'm saying and keep into consideration moving forward. Now, to me, that within itself is priceless. You know, really, this is the type of information that we should be getting from our health care providers, but it's not provided like this. And one of the reasons is because the health industry is a business. And whenever you're in business, it's about profits. So that means that how stuff is done, how information is disseminated, treatments are all based upon profit. That's nothing against our doctors, nothing against our pharmacists, nothing against our nurses, nothing against our nurse assistants, or any person who's in the medical field. It's just what it is, you know. Our healthcare system is a profit-based system, which is the reason why our healthcare system is not constructed in a way whereby anyone is cured of anything, because it's more profitable to treat disease than to eliminate it. Okay. It's more profitable to treat disease than to eliminate it. And when you look at when you look at that from a moral perspective, that's not right. We should not be in a healthcare system that is rewarded by sickness. We shouldn't. And if any one of you disagree with that, feel free. But I just think that we should live in a system where if I'm in a healthcare system, my healthcare should be something that cares for my health, right? So that within itself is its own subject matter. And I won't go there, at least tonight. All right, couple things. I don't know how long this is going to take me. Maybe I can knock it out in an hour. Maybe a little bit more than that. I don't know. I'm just going to take my time to be certain that we go through the information, bottom line. All right, a couple more things before we start. I want to ask you all a question. How many of you know someone who has had a heart attack, had a stroke, or died from a heart attack and died from a stroke? And you may be a part of that. And what I want you to do is I want you to just list the number of people. That way you don't have to include yourself if you don't want people to know. Like if you know two people that had strokes or three people that had strokes, I want you to just put that number. Anthony. Wow. Anthony said he had a heart attack at 42. Wow. 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 Pamela, I know more than five. Wow. Four, three, two people, five people, four to six. It's sad, man. Sad. My friend's husband died last night. Wow. Wow. Look at that. I'm sorry, Kimmy. Kimmy, our prayers are for your friend. I hate that. That's terrible. Six, shout out to Ave. One of my Hawks here. Six people. Four strokes, one heart attack. Five more. My dad, five or more. My dad had a stroke at 50. That was 23 years ago. Wow. All right, another question, because this is a very, very sensitive subject matter. How many of you know individuals who had heart attacks and strokes under the age of 45? Write the amount if you know. Watch this. My dad had a triple bypass at 40. Wow. Four, look, four, three, two, five. Look at this. Geisha says, my daddy died from a heart attack, 58 years old. My mama had one, two, but survived. Wow. Shout out to Coach Andre, several. You know, so what a subject matter, man. I mean, it's just, all right. So what's the good news and the bad news? The bad news is that you all have all of these individuals who have suffered heart attacks and strokes, and many of them have passed away. That's the bad news, that there's nothing we can do about them. The good news is the information that I'm going to share with you on tonight could potentially be what spares your life. Guaranteed. It could be what spares your mother, your father, your friend, somebody you know. So that's the good news. So there's nothing we can do about them, but there is something that we can do for you and each one of you. So that's what we're going to do. And that's how we're going to get started. So everybody ready to start? How has it affected me? Same way with you all. I mean, I know strokes have affected and heart strokes primarily. In my family, I've seen a lot of strokes, and we'll get into that. Heart attacks, not so much in my family. But I, you know, being a pastor, I've preached plenty of eulogies of folk who had massive strokes. My tailor, he was in his 50s, had a massive stroke. Rest in peace, Matthew Weaver. I've known guys in their early 40s had strokes. All right, so we're going to go ahead and get started. Let's go ahead and get started. All right, gang. So this particular conversation is going to start with something, and I really kind of struggle about where to start with this because there's so much to kind of tell. And once again, like always, I've told you all before, I do all of my research and presentations are all original, meaning that I don't like go around the internet looking for presentations and take that and read. I don't do that. All my stuff is original. The layout is original. The research is original. How I'm stringing it together is original. How the points that I'm making is original. And I think it's important for you all to know that, because when you're producing original content, number one, you're being a value to a community, being that you're bringing information that hasn't been brought. And you can take the same information, and if you're packaging it in a different way, that's original stuff. All right. It's important that you know that, as well as you can hear how fluent a person is and what they're talking about in the fluency of how they're speaking. And whenever it's your own information, you can always tell when somebody is, you know, listening to somebody else or when it's their own. So it's important that you all understand that. What I may do, and I'll see, I may present this information and then we come back for a Q&A session, meaning that you have the opportunity to ask whatever questions, because it may be something that you just need to listen to, you may need to hear, and you may need to process. So we'll see what happens. I'm not making any promises with that, but we'll see. All right, before we begin, I want everyone to get a calculator. We're going to do some calculations on tonight. You may need it. I've got some built-in slides that are going to be built in for you to practice, so I can be certain that you're not only hearing the information, but you're comprehending it. All right. So if you've got a calculator on your phone, get it. If you got an old school tally machine, get it. And that's what we're going to do. Let me hold on 1 second. All right. So we're going to start with cholesterol. Cholesterol is something that all of us know about. All right. We've all gotten the test. And we all know about it. Okay. You go to your doctor. Doctor takes a blood draw. And then after the doctor takes the blood draw, you find out your cholesterol is high, is low, and it's normal, or it's normal. We've all been there. So you all know this. Now, the question that I want to bring up initially is, what do my cholesterol numbers mean? So when you get that panel where you go to the doctor, and some of you may have to where it comes to your phone or a portal or whatever, however your doctor disseminates the information to you, all you see is numbers, and you can kind of look at the reference range and says normal or high or low, whatever it is. But the question is, what do they mean? And how do I read my cholesterol numbers? You see, we have to be incessant and informed about our health to the point that we don't need a doctor to tell us what's wrong with us. Doesn't mean we don't need the doctor. Doesn't mean the doctor does not have value. But what I'm saying is, we need to be knowledgeable enough that as it relates to our own health status, that we are with efficacy able to understand what the numbers say. Okay? Do y'all agree with that? Am I coming through loud and clear? All right. Now, this right here is a sample example of what a lipid panel result looks like. I'm going to take my time to parse everything that I can. Lipid. Why do they call it a lipid panel? Because that's what fat and bloods are. They're lipids. Fats are known scientifically as lipids. All right, so a lipid panel is basically the word that is used for a cholesterol test. So when you hear lipids, that's what it is. All right, and what I have before you are two different panel tests. It's something I found on the internet. I have no clue whose numbers these are. I don't know if it was a male. I don't know if it was a woman. But these are examples of how lipid panels are presented. Okay? Now, I'm going to go down each one. I'm going to tell you what each one is. And then I'm going to tell you what each of the actual entries are that equates to cholesterol. All right. Now, this one was taken February 13th, 2018, lipid panel, total cholesterol 226. All right. That's the total cholesterol. Now, I'm going to show you how that's calculated. You look on the right. Here's the scale. For those of you who are in different parts of the world, if you're in the United Kingdom, if you're in Canada, if you're in other parts of the world, your scales may be different because of how we've got different units of measurement. But this just gives you an understanding of what this is. Okay. All right. So this particular person, according to the lipid panel, has high cholesterol. Okay. HDL. HDL is what's known as or referred to as good cholesterol. And the way you can remember it, think of the H in HDL as high or heavenly. All right. Now, HDL stands for high density lipid proteins. That's what the HDL comes from. High density lipid proteins. The HDL, or the good cholesterol as it's called, is the cholesterol that basically sweeps out any contamination or sweeps out the bad stuff that is found in the arteries, if it's inflammation or if it's something that's in the arteries. So the goal of the HDL is to be high. That's why you see on the total cholesterol, you see how it says less than 200. So basically ideal, they want healthy cholesterol to be what? Under 200. But for the HDL, or the what? High density lipid proteins, or the what? Heavenly cholesterol, or the what? Good cholesterol. They want it to be, watch this, greater than, you see that? So the higher your HDL, the better. Okay. Triglycerides, 122. It needs to be, watch this, under 150. Triglycerides are basically the conversion of sugar through the liver. This number is something where the higher it is, the more refined carbohydrates, most times, or high amounts of sugar that you'll find in a person's diet. Triglycerides are the types of lipids that you don't want in your body, and you want them to be lower, hence under 150. You see that? LDL is what's known as bad cholesterol, low density lipid proteins. So the HDL, or the high density lipid proteins, is the good cholesterol. You want that high. The LDL, or the low density lipid proteins, or you can remember it by low, or think about the opposite of high, bad, is the bad cholesterol. Okay. This is high. All right. When you look at the person on the bottom, 369 is their total cholesterol, HDL 54, triglycerides 115, LDL 290. Now, let me tell you how you equate your total cholesterol. Let me tell you how it is calculated. Total cholesterol is your LDL 166 plus your HDL 35 plus 20% of your triglycerides. And I'm going to calculate it so I can show you how they get to this number, because a lot of people don't know how they get to this number. All right, I'm going to show you. All right. 166, that's the LDL, okay, plus 35, that's 201, so that's, you see that? That's LDL plus HDL. Now, so I'm taking the 201, and I'm going to take 20% of the triglycerides. So to get 20% of the triglycerides, which is 122, I'm going to take 122 and multiply it by 0.2, which is 24, you see that? That's 24. 24.4 is 20% of 122. So I add that to the 201. It's 225. You see that? That's how you get your total cholesterol. Now, the reason why I'm taking you through this is because this is something that most people don't know, but you need to understand it. So total cholesterol is an equation that is calculated by taking your LDL plus your HDL, plus 20% of your triglycerides, okay? Are y'all with me? Did I lose anybody? If you look at the person on the bottom, the total cholesterol is derived in the same way. LDL 290 plus HDL 54, plus 20% of triglycerides. That's how they get to the 369. So again, I'm taking time with you to do what our physicians should be doing with us. You understand that? Because if you can be educated, and I'm not skipping any steps with you, so no matter how laborious or slow, or why is he doing that, is I want to put you in a position to where, once again, you're informed and you understand what the heaven is going on when you're in that room. You understand that? So now you know what all the different meanings are. HDL, heavenly cholesterol. That's the good cholesterol. That's why you see that marker on the right, it needs to be high. And this person is low. All right. Now, when I'm looking at this person, I know what is derived from HDL, and most HDL is derived when you're eating a lot of foods that are rich in omega-3s. Why did I tell you to eat the omega-3s? The fish oils or fatty fish, trout, or beef that is grass-fed. Corn-fed beef has lower amounts of omega-3s. The rich omega-3s is what the HDL is good for. That's why I told you to take that, because HDL helps to remove the bad cholesterol from the arteries, setting up what? All right, plaque, leading to what? Heart attacks and strokes. You understand what I'm saying? Okay. Triglycerides. I can oftentimes and always look to see how clean a person is eating. Show me your triglycerides. Triglycerides are basically sugar that is converted into fat. When you're eating a high processed diet, muffins, bagels, bread, pastas, donuts, crackers, your triglycerides are going to be high, 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 high. This is a pro-carbohydrate type of diet. The liver converts it and it turns into what? Triglycerides, LDL, low-density lipoproteins. Now that you understand this, what I want you to understand is the cholesterol test, by and large, is a scam. And I'm going to tell you why it's a scam. It's a scam because this has been the cornerstone in the medical industry. And y'all know it. That physicians use to be the metrics of our cardiovascular health, right? We want to see how healthy our heart is. Let's see what your lipid panel is. But this does not tell anybody anything. This is a scam. The cholesterol traditional lipid panel test is used for nothing more than a mechanism of how pharmaceutical companies can prescribe blood thinners and statin drugs. Now that I've said that, let me prove it. Don't believe anything that I'm saying. Let me prove it. Okay? And I'm not quoting anybody. I'm saying it's a scam. Taking a brand name statin, your doctor may be taking industry money. Now, a lot of people don't understand this. A lot of people do not understand that when you are given a prescription drug, in many instances, the doctors get kickbacks the more prescriptions that are made. This is why I show you my screen. All right, I'm showing you where this comes from. Healthline.com, written by Brian Kranz, updated October 16, 2019. A Harvard study shows doctors who take industry payouts are more likely to prescribe brand name drugs, which is driving up what? Unnecessary healthcare spending. Some of the most excessive healthcare spending involves the purchase of cholesterol lowering statins. Did you see that? Some of the most excessive healthcare spending, that's industry, healthcare, not just your doctor, not just where you are, healthcare. So the whole system, some of the most excessive healthcare spending involves what? The purchase of what? Cholesterol lowering statins. But research suggests there's a reason for that. The research, which confirms earlier findings, suggests that if doctors take money from pharmaceutical companies, even just for a free lunch, they're more likely to prescribe more expensive brand name drugs. Researchers from Brigham and Women's Hospital and Harvard Medical School reviewed the records of 1.6 million prescriptions for statins covered by Medicare Part D in Massachusetts in 2011. Of the 2,444 doctors in the Medicare prescribing database, almost 37% received industry payments. That's more than a third. Research found that physicians who didn't receive industry money prescribed brand name statins at a rate of almost 18%. those who did take money prescribed brand name drugs at a rate of almost 23%. Overall, researchers found that for every $1,000 spent on doctors, brand name drug prescriptions increased 1%, 0.1%. The reason why I'm showing you this is because the lipid panel test is the hook that is used for a doctor to suggest if you should have a statin or not. That's why it's a scam. And the reason why it's a scam is because you cannot look at somebody's basic statin lipid panel, which is what? You cannot look at this and tell if a person how healthy they are or are not. Cholesterol tests do not provide, when I say cholesterol tests, I'm talking about standard lipid testing, what I just showed you. When I say cholesterol test, I'm talking about this lipid panel. Like when you go and you get your physical and they do that little rinky dink little test and they show you these four little pitiful numbers. Okay? They do not provide insight to heart health. They are used to sell drugs. A basic lipid panel cannot accurately predict heart disease or risk of a heart attack or stroke. It can't do it. It can't. And look at this. Most major heart attacks occur in people with normal cholesterol. Science Daily. I got receipt source. Alina Health. Summary. Researchers wanted to find out if new statin guidelines were affecting the number of heart attacks. What they found was promising, but revealed a basic flaw in preventative care. For decades, national guidelines on which Americans should take cholesterol-lowering medications relied heavily, watch this, on an individual's level of what? Bad cholesterol. So what they're doing, they're looking at these pitiful tests and allowing the course of treatment to be based on a test that doesn't tell you a damn thing. Do you understand that? For all y'all who may be in your feelings, or if you in the medical industry and your butt hurt, I don't care. You understand? I'm not talking directly to any individual. Before you get mad at me, let me finish. Let me finish. I don't care if you're in your feelings. Risk factors of heart disease or stroke is not connected to the levels of cholesterol, but rather cholesterol that is oxidized and becomes oxidated. So here's where I'm coming to the deep end. But before I get there, when you look at this powerful piece of information, what I'm just telling you, most heart attacks occur in people with normal cholesterol, research findings. The data on statins clearly shows that individuals with normal cholesterol levels can also reduce their risk of heart attacks, said Michael Medema, cardiologist with Minneapolis Heart Institute. Principal investigator for Minneapolis Heart Institute. However, the study found that more than half of the patients had not seen a physician in 2 years prior to the heart attack. The more recent cholesterol guidelines are clearly a big step in the right direction, but we need to have better systems and incentives in place to get patients the assessment, that's testing, and treatments that could potentially be life-saving. So at the beginning of this particular presentation, when I asked y'all, how many people do you know that have had heart attacks and strokes? By and large, according to the statistics, most of them went to their doctor, got a lipid panel, and when they got it, if they got it, it was normal. The lipid panel is nothing more than what is used to prescribe drugs. They are trained when your LDL is over a certain amount or when your total cholesterol is over a certain amount, according to this, then you get, you should issue your patient this type of statin drug. And we recommend this dose and monitor to do this. That's how it works. That's all that test is about. You cannot look at the test and tell if a person is likely to have a heart attack. Now, would you not think that it would make sense to have a test that will give me insight? And see, the thing about it is they know what I'm telling you. The industry knows this. I'm reading the same stuff they read. They know it. The lipid test is cheap. It's easy to be ordered. They can get it quickly. And they can massage the numbers to say, oh, your cholesterol. Anybody in America is going to have high cholesterol. Do you understand that? But they never tell you the side effects of the statin drugs. Do y'all understand what I'm saying? It's just the truth. And let's keep going. Now, let me tell you why you have heart attacks, why you have strokes. Now, there are instances where people can have heart attacks and can be in perfect health. Y'all know that. Graves, some graves are long, some are short. Some folk die young, some people die early. There are people that just die and there's no reason given. But in the vast majority, you need to understand why heart attacks happen. Risk factors of heart disease or stroke is not connected to levels of cholesterol, meaning what? There are folk who have high cholesterol who are healthy as oxes. Likewise, there are people who have low cholesterol who are not healthy. As a matter of fact, they're starting to see in some regards that low cholesterol is just as bad as high. So let me break this down. Look at what I've written. Risk factors of heart disease or stroke is not connected to levels of cholesterol, but rather cholesterol that is oxidated or becomes oxidated. So it's not the cholesterol in my body in terms of how much or little it is, but it's what is the cholesterol that's in my blood doing? See, that's oxidation, deterioration. When cholesterol becomes oxidized, and if you don't know what oxidized, stay with me because I'm gonna tell you all of it. I'm ready. This is what leads to the issue. All right, Dr. Joe, well, what oxidates cholesterol, being that, to your point, that what causes heart attacks and strokes is not the level of cholesterol in the blood, but oxidation. All right, here we go. The causes and effects of oxidized LDL cholesterol. Now, let me see how good you are. How many remember what LDL was? Is LDL the good cholesterol or the bad cholesterol? Let me see who's paying attention. Good. It's bad. It's bad. When I say bad, stay with me, because LDL isn't necessarily bad when you understand everything that's going on, but we're using it for clarity of speech because that's what it has been called. HDL has been called good cholesterol. LDL has been called bad cholesterol. Now, I said that what causes heart attacks and strokes is not the level of cholesterol, but the oxidation of the cholesterol in the body. So it's not how much I have, but what is the cholesterol that's in me doing? Watch this. Oxidized low-density lipid proteins, LDL, remember, low meaning bad, is a potentially harmful type of cholesterol that is produced in the body when normal LDL cholesterol is damaged by chemical interactions. What's it saying? It's saying that what oxidates the cholesterol is when something in the environment of the blood is interfering with it. Meaning what? That's why the research is suggesting that people who are having strokes and heart attacks had normal cholesterol. Because it's not about how much. It's about what the cholesterol that is in my body is doing. And according to this particular article, it says it's when normal LDL cholesterol is damaged by what? Chemical interactions. Do y'all follow me? Do you follow me? So it's not the amount, but it's what's happening in my blood. It's what's happening in my brain. It's what's happening in my body. So chemical interactions, what could that be? Well, certain food, my habits, what I'm around. What is it in our environment? You can produce high levels of oxidized LDL if you have excessive free radical formation or simply high LDL cholesterol. How oxidized LDL forms. The oxidation of LDL is thought to occur when LDL cholesterol and particles in your body react with free radicals, unstable molecules that are produced as a result of normal metabolism, a disease, or exposure to toxins. Free radicals can cause oxidation, a type of chemical destabilization of molecules such as LDL cholesterol. The oxidized LDL itself then becomes more reactive when the surrounding tissues, which can produce inflammation that leads to disease and organs damage. LDL cholesterol molecules are not at all the same size, and some are larger than others. Smaller LDL particles are more likely to become oxidized, making them more detrimental to your health. Here are some of the examples of things, being that oxidation is a chemical interaction. I'm gonna bring it home to you. I know there's a lot of fodder in there, but I want to take my time with you so you're clear on tonight. We're trying to save lives. We're trying to save lives. All right. Now, some risk factor. Watch this. Consuming a diet that is high in what? Trans fat. Go back to the first week that I taught you. Reading what? Food labels. Remember when I broke this down? We went over ingredients. We went over portions. We went over calories. And I broke down fats for you. I taught you what saturated fats were. I taught you what unsaturated fats were. But I told you the fat that you never want is what kind of fat? Trans fat. Trans fat. Come on, somebody. Do y'all remember that? Do you remember it? Do y'all remember it? I'm going to be up all night. I'm hot. Do you remember? Don't rush me tonight. Y'all remember that? You remember? You remember what trans fats were in? Huh? Anybody remember? Let me see how good you are. Can somebody give me one thing trans fats were in? Let me see how good my pupils are. Let me see how good my students are. Let me see how good you are. Let me see how good you are. Give me an example. Who gonna get it first? Just one. Thank you. Reese's Cups, instant noodles, packaged foods. There you go, y'all. Processed sweets, donuts. Yes, 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 my students. Vegan butter. Yes, hot dogs, margarine, coffee. Yes, my students. Hydrogenated oils. Go on with your bad self, Carl. That's what I'm talking about. Yes. 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 Package all the stuff. I wish I could say something else. I wish I could. All the stuff that you should avoid. The peanut butters, the candies, the cookies, the frozen, the TV dinners, all that crap, seed oils. When you're eating those things, those foods and that trans fat is interacting with the cholesterol that does what? Oxidates it. Yes, my students. You see why I teach you like this. Look at another one. Look at this one. Smoking. Smoking. When you smoke, it increases your likelihood of heart attacks and strokes, cancers, because when you're smoking, you're basically choking your body. And the contaminants in the smoke is oxidating the cholesterol. This is the reason why people who smoke have heart attacks. This is why. Come on, what's something else? Poorly controlled diabetes. All of my diabetics, listen, diabetics are more likely to have a heart attack or stroke than a person who has already had a heart attack or stroke. Why? Because when you have diabetes, you have a what? Metabolic condition. Metabolic meaning what? Your body's ability or inability to metabolize what? Energy. To all of my diabetics, you have got to heal yourself. You got to reverse your condition. And if you go back to all those people that had heart attacks or strokes, I guarantee you a large amount of them were diabetics. What else? Metabolic syndrome. Metabolic syndrome is when you go and you say, do you have high blood pressure? Yes. Do you have high cholesterol? Yes. Are you a diabetic? Yes. When you click three or more, that's metabolic syndrome. Yes, all types of smoking. Exposure to toxins through pollution and preservatives, stress. So these are the things. Now, the thing is, it's one thing when you look at individuals who just eat crappily, or a person who smokes, but think of the folk that you know that eat bad, smoke, and got diabetes and hypertension. The more of this stuff on the list, the more it is oxidizing and pushing you to the direction to where you just may get to the point to where you have a heart attack or stroke. Well, Dr. Joe, if you say the basic lipid panel is not a good device used to show me if I could potentially be at risk. Now, what if your doctor sat you down and really gave you good intelligence, good intel off what you had? Dr. Joe, how do I really discover if I'm at risk of a heart attack or stroke? Now, what I'm about to tell you now is I'm going to show you now what is a better indication of a potential risk while using the basic lipid panel. That's what I'm about to show you. I'm about to show you how we can do something with numbers that's all scientific, that's all supported by the medical industry. But for whatever reason, nobody does this to us. And the way you do it is you take your total cholesterol and you divide it by your triglycerides. And the number should be below 5. Now, if all you have is a basic lipid test, which is the test that I already showed you. Now look at this. Because see, again, I'm coming with receipts because I don't want y'all to think. See, when you are a person who's not an MD, right? That's me. I'm not a medical doctor. But I'm having conversations about medicine. I need to come with medical fodder. And I need to be able to talk about it intelligently and comprehensively, to where folk don't think I'm just, you know, an outsider. No, I know what I'm talking about. And I'm going to show you where I'm getting my information from. And then I'm going to use my preaching skills, come on somebody, and tell the story better than your own doctor. This comes from the Mayo Clinic. It says cholesterol ratio or non-HDL cholesterol, which is more important? How important is cholesterol ratio and non-HDL cholesterol for predicting your what? What does that say? Risk. Many doctors win now believe that determining your non-HDL cholesterol level may be more useful than calculating your cholesterol ratio. And either option appears to be a better risk predictor than your total cholesterol level or even your low density lipid proteins. Do you see my receipts? To calculate your cholesterol ratio, divide your total cholesterol by your what? HDL. So that your total number is 200 by, if it's 200 milligrams per deciliter by 5.2, and your HDL is 50 or 1.3, your ratio will be 4-1. Higher ratio means a higher risk of heart disease. Ideal, you want to be lower than 5. The lower it is, the better. So being that I'm ready for you, let's practice. You remember our first patient? Remember the unknown person that Dr. Joe got from the internet? Let's take the information I've just taught you. Let's say, for instance, you got your lipid panel. You can do the same thing with yours. What do? You take your total cholesterol. All right? Let's look at this one. 226. Divided by your what? HDL, 35, equals, you see that? 6.45. So this person, although their total cholesterol is only 26 above, is at a greater risk of a heart attack or stroke. The ratio that I just taught you is a better indication of risk than total cholesterol. Why is this preacher telling the people this? I ain't been to medical school. Why am I telling you this? Huh? Let's look at the other one. Total cholesterol, 369 divided by HDL, 54, 6.83. Now look, the one on the bottom, it looks like he or she is tremendously worse than the one on the top. But both of them have a risk level that is above a 6. You see? Now look at this one. I want y'all to calculate this. Total cholesterol, 255, triglycerides, 39, HDL, 90, VDL, very low density lipid proteins, 6, LDL, 161. Do this one and tell me what you get. Now, This person is deemed as having what? High cholesterol. Doctors would recommend this person to be on what? Statins. All right, look. Now, these are my numbers. Do you understand that? You saw what the document said. Below 5, the closer to 1, the better. The lower, the better. But yet this particular panel has high cholesterol. These are my numbers back in September. Look how low my triglycerides are, 39. You see that? Look how high my HDL, 90. You see? Very low density lipid protein, 6. The lowest is a 5. But my LDL is high. And the reason why my LDL is high is because the metabolism I have is fat burning. I don't eat a lot of carbohydrates. Now, if I lowered my LDL, it would lower that overall ratio. But the point is, I'm giving you an example of how a person would be put on statins. But according to research, they're healthy. So play with your numbers. Maybe you want to do it now. Maybe you want to do it later. What I recommend is let's keep on going through the presentation. And then when you get off, you can go to your old records. You can look at your mama's stuff. You can look at everybody's stuff. And y'all don't mess it up now. You getting the wrong numbers. Well, Dr. Joe said divide the triglycerides by the LDL. I got 47. I wonder, should I go to the hospital now? Okay. I'm not gonna stop. I promise. I'm not. Oh God. Okay. I digress. Focus. I'm sorry, y'all. Y'all know I just. All right. Let's keep going. All right. Now. There is a test. Now, what I just shared with you was if you have nothing else, all you got is a lipid panel. That's all you got. The ratio, according to the recent science, is going to be a better indication for heart disease, for a potential risk, than just looking at total cholesterol. However, there is a test that all of you need to order. And it's called an advanced lipid panel. Okay? What does it do, Dr. Joe? It gives deeper insight to the health of your heart, as well as it will show you how your body, watch this, is packaging cholesterol and if there are any signs of inflammation. The inflammation and oxidized cholesterol is what leads to the heart attack or stroke. There are tests you can order right now that will tell you exactly what your body and how your body is packaging cholesterol. This is what it looks like. Look at how more expansive. A basic lipid panel is only going to give you this. See that? But this has subfractions. It takes the LDL particle, the LDL small, LDL medium, HDL large. This gives the physician more insight to what your body and how your body is packaging. You see? The name of this test is called Cardio IQ. Hold on. Now, look at this. Advanced lipid testing. Do you know your data? Did you know that the standard lipid panel results, that's what we went over, that many people get from their doctor's office might be slightly or even completely wrong? It's a scary thought for anyone concerned about their heart health, and yet many people get lipid lab assessments based on lab methodologies that are decades old. However, there's a better lab test for people who want to know their real data without breaking the bank, all right? For many years, the standard lipid panel test has been used to take a snapshot of specific types of fats in the blood. Inexpensive and easy to perform, the lipid panel is a helpful way to get a baseline screen in people who are getting started with measuring their blood markers or are generally healthy. To better understand why lipid panel is useful and how it relates to our heart and vascular health, let's take a look at our cardiovascular system and the concept of cardiovascular disease. Now, basically, what this does, the advanced lipid testing breaks down the cholesterol in subfractions. You see, it tells you what the LDL particle was. I've already told you that. But look at the other ones that it also includes. ApoB test. Apolipid proteins are molecules that transport fats in the blood. Cholesterol and other fats cannot move through the blood by themselves, so they hook up and bind with apolipid proteins to get to where they need to go. Apolipid protein B or ApoB is a specific, nasty type of lipid protein. ApoB likes to help bad stuff accumulate in our blood walls, forming little buildups called plaques. Over time, a plaque can get, watch this, big enough to what? Break open to cause a what? Blood vessel blockage, leading to a what? Bad event like what? A heart attack or stroke. So let's go back to the chart. You see, did you see that ApoB? You see that right here? This particular test picks up on that and can tell your physician what's going on in your arteries before you stroke out. Where can I order? Let me finish. Jeez. Lipid protein A. The lipid protein A test, also known as LPA test, measures the level of LPA in blood. LPA is a lipid protein and is a risk factor for cardiovascular disease and a condition called aortic stenosis or narrowing of major vessels known as the aorta. LPA levels are thought to be determined by one's genes, and levels remain fairly stable over one's lifetime. LPA levels of 155 nanometers per liter, some tests use 75, are considered high. Although the LPA test is not frequently performed as part of standard lab tests, up to 20% of people may have an abnormal LP test level. Unfortunately, high LPA levels cannot be effectively managed by changing one's lifestyle because it's genetic. If one has elevated LPA, one should consider specific types of supplements and other intravenous in conjunction with a qualified medical provider. Also, if someone has a high LPA test, it is likely that other family members do as well, and they should also consider a LPA test. So the point of the test of the advanced lipid panel is to give the doctor or you a better understanding of what's going on. Now, the way you get this test is you can do it two ways. A, you can go through your doctor. You get on the phone, you call your doctor, you say, "Doctor, I would like an advanced lipid panel and I would like for you to order it for me." You call your doctor and you tell your doctor's office, "I want an advanced lipid panel test." Some of your doctors may not be able to do that based upon your insurance or whatever it is. But if you don't want to use your insurance, you can go to questdiagnostic.com and you can order this. It's $200. It may be less in some places. You order the test from Quest Diagnostics. Just Google Quest, Q-U-E-S-T, D-I-A-G-O-N-I-S-T-I-C-S, or Diagnostics, and put Cardio IQ, or you can put Google. And y'all, I'm not going to do all this for you. I'm telling you so you can do it. You can call your doctor and request an advanced lipid panel test, or you can go to Quest Diagnostics and look it up. When you order it, they'll send you information. They'll tell you the nearest laboratory to your house. When you go in, you find the time that you go in, you fast, you follow the instructions, they take your blood, they send it off, and they get it back to you. It's very, very easy. Okay? So two ways to get it. Call your doctor. Say, I want an advanced lipid panel. Now, what's funny is when folks start calling doctors, telling them what to order, doctors start acting, well, who told you to do that? And let me tell you how it's a scam. Because when your general healthcare practitioner, some of them can't do nothing. They got to call on a specialist, a cardiologist. Y'all feel what I'm saying? I call mine and he says, well, you got to go to a cardiologist. And when you call the cardiologist, the first available is September. Hell, somebody can die by then. And y'all know I'm telling the truth. The general practitioner is nothing more than the quarterback pitching to the specialist. Oh, you got to go to the nephrologist. Your kidneys are messed up. You got to go to the oncologist. Your prostate is full. You got to go to the podiatrist. Your feet hurt. What can you do? Now, let me go a step further. Let's say, for instance, you are worried and you want to know exactly what's going on the inside of me and exactly what's going on inside of my arteries. Here is another test that you can do. And I recommend doing these tests in conjunction because it's not going to do anything more than give you more intelligence about your health to avoid heart attack or stroke. If you are concerned about your heart health, you can request what is called a CC scan or a coronary calcium scan. Come on, Dr. Joe. Come on. This is what the scan does. It measures calcification in your body. And whenever there is calcium in the body, it's a sign that the plaque has done what? Hardened. And when it hardens, the test picks it up and it shows bright white. And I've got this particular scan so you can see it. The far right, you can see severe calcification. Moderate, you see that? And normal. And they can measure your age and give you a calcium score. This test, if you have insurance, it depends. But it'll cost about $100. If you don't have insurance, I've seen people who've done it for $300, $400, maybe $500. Is this something that you have to do? No, I'm just telling you everything that is out there to give you the peace of mind. And the technology is there to tell us, but folks are just dying and don't know. The test takes 5 minutes. You don't have to take any shots. It's no dye. It's very simple. I did it myself. And this is what the results look like. Technique non-contrast perspective, ECG, gated CT of the heart was performed with a multi-role detector, CT during suspended respiration. Coronary calcium score was measured on a 3D computer workstation. Findings, coronary arteries, calcium absent, total score zero. That's what you want. The only thing you want in your arteries is blood and fat and nutrients. You understand that? Now, if you have a zero calcium score, it does not necessarily mean that you don't have problems, because a calcium score shows what the buildup has been, not necessarily what's going on now. Do you see what I'm saying? That's why I said that using the advanced lipid test and the calcium score is a great way for you to have the peace of mind. You feel what I'm saying? Next. Oh, this is the hardest one. The APOE gene. Oh, all right. This is difficult. Stay with me. Please pay attention. It may sound like you're in school, but please pay attention. The APOE gene provides instructions for making a protein called apolipoprotein. You remember we went over that, little A. You remember that? E. This protein combines with fats, lipids, in the body to form molecules called lipid proteins. Lipid proteins, lipoproteins, are responsible for packaging cholesterol and other fats and carrying them through the bloodstream. So let me break that down. The APOE gene is a gene that basically is expressing through your ancestry how your body packages lipids. All right, now you're going to start to hear the connection between what I'm teaching you now and Black health. The gene is what, so your expression of this gene, you inherited it from your parents. And there are different combinations of the gene. And the different combinations is what basically tells you how your body packages cholesterol. Everyone has two copies of the APOE gene. Why? Because you got a mother, you got a father. People with E2 have the what? Lowest overall risk for Alzheimer's, and those with E4 have the highest risk. The other combinations are APOE, E23, E24, 33, and 34 fall in between. I have APOE E4. That's the one you don't want. I got it. The APOE gene is a gene that tells us our risk of heart disease and Alzheimer's. I did a genetic test years ago, found out I had it. And the E4 means that I got the gene from mom. Stay with me. And I got the gene from dad. The APOE gene is the gene that is directly correlated with Alzheimer's and heart disease. Stay with me. On my mother's side, My grandmother and my grandfather, my mother's mother and father, both had Alzheimer's. My grandfather, at the end of his life, didn't know. And you all have seen this, I'm sure y'all have. You've got relatives that had Alzheimer's. I'm not the only one. I remember when my granddad was getting older in age, great man. He started to forget where stuff was, and it starts slowly. Then I remember granddaddy, he didn't know where the bathroom was. And he slowly declined. And I know many of y'all, that's what I'm saying, it's tough for me to talk about this. And it's tough for me to talk about this, not because I got the gene. I'm not because of that. Because I'm going to tell you why I'm not worried. My grandmother, when my grandfather died first on my mother's side. And after granddaddy died, my grandmother went downhill. Y'all know when people are married for such a long time, they can't live without each other. I hope God allows Lynette and I to live a long life. And I hope we in our like hundreds and we die on a plane coming back from St. Lucia. Oh God, forgive me. Shoot. Anyway, but after granddad died, my grandmama went downhill. When my grandmother transitioned, she didn't know who we were. On dad's side, both my grandfather, his father, and his brother both died of strokes. So what I'm saying is this gene that scientists are saying is a correlation with Alzheimer's and heart disease, I see it, and I got E4. Now, stay with me. Why do we need to know this? The APO gene is a gene that tells us our risk of heart disease and Alzheimer's. Look at this. APOE4 is not associated with Alzheimer's disease in elderly Nigerians. Now, watch this. I'm not going to read this, but let me tell you what it says. But I just want to have my receipts. There is something called the Nigerian paradox. Watch this. Here it comes. Nigerians are the largest group of black people ethnically in the world. So when as it relates to like African Americans or a certain ethnic set of people, they are the largest group of black people on the planet. Nigerians, facts. Nigerians, watch this, have the highest amount of this gene. APOE44. Do you hear me? Nigerians, out of all the people in the world, got the highest amount of the APOE4 gene. Yet, although they have the presence of this gene, they got one of the lowest occurrences of heart disease and Alzheimer's. My God. Watch this, because you ain't gonna believe me.
Back in the 1990s, a major susceptibility gene was discovered for Alzheimer's, called APOE4. If we have one APOE4 gene, either from our mom or dad, like about 15% of the U.S. population does, our risk of getting Alzheimer's is tripled. And if we are like one of the 1 in 50 folks who have APOE4 genes from both parents, we may be at 9 times the risk. The highest frequency of APOE4 in the world is in Nigeria, but they also have some of the lowest Alzheimer's rates. To understand this paradox, one has to understand the role of APOE. What does the APOE gene do? APOE is the principal cholesterol carrier in the brain. So their diet appeared to have trumped their genes, their low cholesterol levels, from their low intake of animal fat, living off mostly grains, vegetables. High APOE4, but Alzheimer's a rarity, thanks perhaps to their low cholesterol level, which any of us can achieve eating healthfully too. These findings suggest that long-term changes in plasma cholesterol can lead to changes in APOE gene expression. Just because we may have been dealt some bad genetic cards doesn't mean we can't reshuffle the deck with diet. We can't change our genetic makeup, but we can reduce or prevent high cholesterol. In the study of 1,000 people for over 20 years, APOE4 doubled the odds of Alzheimer's, but high cholesterol nearly tripled the threat. So the risk for Alzheimer's disease from treatable factors, elevated cholesterol and blood pressure, appears to be greater than that from the dreaded Alzheimer's susceptibility gene. In fact, projecting from their data, controlling lifestyle factors could reduce a person's risk for Alzheimer's disease, even if they had the double-barreled, you know, APOE4 gene from both parents, from 9 or 10 times the odds down to just 2. People tend to have a fatalistic view about developing Alzheimer's disease. Like, look, it's going to happen if it's going to...
Now, that particular... You heard that. Look, because some of y'all missed it. Nigerians have the highest occurrence of the APOE4 gene. You heard it. But one of the lowest occurrences of Alzheimer's and heart disease. Due to what? Diet. Now, a lot of Black Americans have Nigerian blood. I'm one of them. When I did my ancestry DNA, like many of you have, there are many of us in this country got Nigerian blood. A lot of our ancestors were West African Nigerians. I had a high amount, like almost 30% of the Black part of me is from Nigeria. Now, the weird thing about what's going on is not the fact that Black folks in Nigeria got the gene but aren't dying, but they've done the same study in Indiana, African Americans who got the same gene and have high amounts of heart disease and stroke and Alzheimer's. Alzheimer's is nothing more than plaque that is on the brain. It's like when you think of a heart attack of clogged arteries, it's a brain that has plaque on it. The body can't metabolize the cholesterol, so it creates sediments and it becomes what? Oxidized. And when that oxidation of the plaque on the brain interferes with, watch this, neurotransmitters, which leads to what? Mental decline, which leads to what? Granddaddy not knowing where the bathroom is, or grandmama not remembering who I am. They're even referencing Alzheimer's as type 3 diabetes. What's the point? The point is your genes loads the gun, but your diet pulls the trigger. This is what I tried to tell you the other day in Black Health. I told you that Black people are not designed to eat high volumes of fat. I told you that, and this is a prime example. We can't eat that stuff. It's not that something's wrong with Nigerians. No, they just eating like their ancestors. That's why they're not dying. But we who are in the West, who are eating all of this crap, we are getting heart disease and strokes because the diet is pulling the trigger. And our diet is mitigating the full expression of how our ancestors ate. I told you this last week. Do you understand what I'm saying? Do you understand what I guarantee you? Many of the people that you've lost had this same gene, but aren't eating according to their ancestry. Do you understand that? These are the same folk out here eating Popeye's chicken sandwich and think it's cute. Chitlins, oxtails, hog maws, cheese, dairy, cereal, donuts. We weren't made to eat like that. The Nigerian folk ain't got a problem. It's the American folk who don't know how to eat because we don't have a culture. Black people don't have a culture. That's why we sway towards anything. That's why. That's why people, and you ain't gonna like this, like Cardi B are talking to Joe Biden when he was running for president like she's a spokesperson for black folk, and nobody was irate about that. That's what happens when you don't have a culture. We were stoked when Black Panther came out, and every Negro that I knew thought he was in Wakanda. Wakanda's fictional, but we gravitated towards that because we want that. And that's why I respect my African brothers and sisters who are from South Africa, and our Nigerian brothers and sisters and our West African brothers and sisters. They come over here and they keep their culture. They eat like their grandparents eat. That's what they're supposed to do. Do you understand that? Don't let that narrative when they're trying to put African Americans against Africans, that's all BS, because I've never met an African that I had a problem with. Never. Every time I went to Africa, they treated me like royalty. Don't believe that. Don't believe that. We make fun of them. People make fun of them in their garb. I'm glad they wear their African regalia. In their sandals. That's their culture. They got certain customs. That's what black people in America are missing. We don't have a culture. That's why we do stupid stuff. And that's why we let drug dealers and amoral people be in positions of leadership. What is T.I. and Killer Mike have anything doing telling black people what we need to do in our communities? Why? You butthurt. I don't care, but I'm right. I am right. Black people do not have a culture, and this is one of the things that is affecting us in terms of our health. Now, I'm not through. Don't rush me, because I got something. I'm trying to tell you how you can get tested. What's your status? I've saved somebody's life with this. Do you understand that? All of us should be tested. Now, where can you go? Now, I cannot tell you. Listen to me. I picked up the phone and called my doctor once and said, how can I get an ApoE test? You know what he told me? What is that? What is that? He didn't know. I'm not expecting my doctor to know everything. But if somebody comes to me and says, hey, do you know anything about the Apocrypha? Yes. Do you know about eschatology? Yes. Do you know about the infancy gospel of Thomas? Yes. I don't know everything about the Bible, but it ain't much you're going to be able to ask me that I don't know something about. I spent 10 years working on my degree. And I call them and ask them for a test, and you say, what is that? So let me help you out. Let me help you out. Because I found a place that'll do this test reputable company that many of you have heard of. It's called 23andMe. And they do a lot of different testing. And I got it right here. You can go to their site. You see late onset Alzheimer's disease. You can go here and you can buy the test if you chose to. And I guess it gives you a combination. And y'all, I haven't gone on here. I don't know which one to click. You're going to have to look at it yourself. But I did want to show it to you. You can get this on 23andMe, and I wanted to show you that. So if you want to take some time, you see, late onset Alzheimer's disease is influenced by genetics. The E4 variant and the APOE gene is the most common genetic variant associated with the disease. This means that people with at least one copy of the E4 variant may have an increased risk. I already taught you what that was. So they do the test. Now, well, Dr. Joe, what if I got it? Well, first of all, there ain't nothing you can do if you got it. This is genes. But let me help you to feel better. If you have that 4-4 gene, there is no need to worry. Well, Dr. Joe, if I have it, what should I do and what does that mean? Three things. Your consumption of saturated fats must be monitored. That means you're going to have to get away from all the ribeyes, all the strips, all the steaks, a lot of the cheese and dairy that I already told you we don't process well anyway. And you're going to have to eat more polyunsaturated, monounsaturated fats like fatty fish and trout and salmon and avocado and tree nuts and cooking in olive oil. At lower temperatures, because when you cook olive oil too high and it smokes, guess what happens to the fat? It oxidates. Come on, somebody. Come on. Ugh. Two, if you have this gene, you can never, ever, never be a diabetic. You cannot. If you are a diabetic with this gene, you are guaranteed almost to have a heart attack, a stroke, or Alzheimer's. You have to heal yourself. Do you hear me? Three, you must retain a high level of fitness. You cannot be gut and butt. You cannot. In essence, everything you need to do, if you got it, guess what? You're doing it now. That's the beauty. Everything you need to do, you are doing it now. Plant-based eating, caloric restrictions, high amounts of water, being physically active, being consistent, lowering obesity, reversing diabetes, lowering metabolic syndrome. You're doing it now. Each of you need to meet the best doctor who can take care of you for the rest of your life. And the best doctor in the world you can find is this. Now, I wanted to wait for this, but I'm about to give y'all a great site. And this particular doctor that you're going to meet is a website. Once you get off, all you got to do is go to this particular website. Everything is done virtually. All types of insurance are taken. I want you to get all of your information because I'm about to tell you who the best doctor is. The best doctor is www.you.com. You are your best doctor. And if somebody goes to www.you.com, I'm putting you out because you know I'm joking. You are your best doctor. You are your best doctor. You are. And I'm going to tell you why. Don't rush me. Your health is more valuable to you than anyone else. You have access to the same information as your doctors. You can research case studies, treatments, causes, and others who had similar issues. You know what you feel better than a doctor or a test. Nobody knows what you feel better than you. Your doctor doesn't know as much as you think he or she does. They not that. I've known some brilliant, listen. There's some brilliant doctors, but there's some idiots too. Idiots. Idiots. You can conduct your own test on yourself. Every test that I wanted, I ordered it. My doctor didn't order the CRT, the CCT test. He didn't order that. I had a concern. I knew about my APOE44 status, and I wanted to be my own research because it's my behind on the line. I wanted to know the status of my arteries. I've ordered another advanced lipid test. I do it once to twice a year. I want to have a better understanding of nutrition, to continue to push myself in the knowledge. And you know what? I don't mind having a gene because I can help somebody else. You cannot afford to have diabetes. Diabetes is the worst disease that you can have in terms of longevity and high quality of life. And if you are a diabetic, I don't want you to feel like I'm shaming you, but I do want you to feel that I am supporting you and pushing you to reverse it. You can reverse it. You're doing it. Keep pushing. Do you understand that? Y'all, I'm giving you my best tonight. That presentation right there just saved somebody's life. Saved somebody's life. Now, how many of you all feel that you need or would like some time to process this and we do a Q&A? Let me know what you think. If you feel you got it, great. You know, I'm fine. If you feel you got it, I'm fine. I mean, that information, I'm not saying it just because I said, but it was so comprehensive, man. It just tells a full story. And like I told you, you take those testings with the ratio, the advanced lipid testing, the CCT testing, and the APOE. I mean, that's a weapon to know. You see what I'm saying? It's a great weapon. And it's so sad that those people that you all know and that we know who have lost their lives. But let me tell you something. People say, well, why? More people need to hear this. More people need to hear this. Let me tell you that. No, they don't. Because if I took this information and broadcast it, black folk would share it with each other. People, look at this. Ain't this great information? Guess what? They ain't gonna change a damn thing. They not. I can't help people like that. You have already worked on you. You are putting in the work. That's why I spent 25 hours putting together this presentation for free. Because I saved somebody's life tonight, probably more than one. And you can't put a dollar amount on life. Do you understand that? You cannot. Somebody's going to be with their children longer because of tonight's lesson. I know that. Somebody's going to be able to fulfill their purpose because of tonight's message. Somebody's going to be able to change somebody else's life that you wouldn't have been able to change because you didn't live long enough to meet them. Do you understand that? Why is it free? It's free. All these markets, it's free. You know how much money you can make? You know how much money you can't charge? None of y'all got enough money to pay me the information that I have shared with you. And I know that. I'm not saying that arrogantly, saying, look, I'm not saying that. I know that. You can't afford what I've given you. Nobody can. You cannot put a price on somebody changing their lives for the better. You cannot. Or their children, or their husband, or their mother, or getting in the mirror and looking and feeling good about yourself. You can't put a dollar amount. You don't have enough money. You don't have it. You don't have it. That's why it's free, because you can't afford what it's worth. Do you understand what I'm saying? So, what you do, take the information. I never remove these presentations. It'll stay here. You can watch as many times as you want. Over the next day or so, I'll let you know when we'll do a live Q&A. Now, the Q&A needs to be you having prepared intelligent questions. Don't be up here asking me, Dr. Joe, I couldn't find 23andMe, but I found 23andThee. Is that the same website, Dr. Joe? Y'all don't come up here saying that to me. Have questions that you thought about. Oh, God. I have to stop. Have questions, let me break it down, that you've thought about. Write them down, and I'll pick a time when we spend a little time together, maybe tomorrow, maybe Friday. I'll do my best, okay? So I hope you all enjoyed tonight's session and lesson. Have a great evening. Love each of you. Really explore the information. Let me tell you something. To all of you who are Caucasian and Hispanic and Latino, this is not a black disease, the APO4 gene. I think everybody should be tested. I think everybody should be tested. One of the things that I want to do, I want to be in a position, because I know people don't have money. A lot of people don't have money, but I want to be in a position one day to where we can pay for the test of 30 people or 50 people. That's why when it's time for us to sow our seeds, that everybody participates so we can do that. That could save somebody's life. That can save somebody's life. So when it's time for you to sow your seeds, I don't want to hear no hemming and hawing. I don't want to hear none of that. I do not want to hear none of that. We're going to fall in line and we're going to sow and help the next class who is in just as great of a need as you were when you came into this one. I love y'all. Have an amazing night. And I'll see you on the next one.